independent. They knew their own spirit. And we're going to hear all about that with drummer Simon Crowe after their debut single from 1977, Looking After Number One, on Richard Green's Retro Show. Richard Green on the BBC in the Southwest. That's the Boomtown Rats and Looking After Number One. And from the Boomtown Rats, Simon Crowe, the drummer, is with me in the studio today. What a sound.
Thank you.
What a song.
Good day. Hello.
Yeah, it's good, isn't it? That was the intent, I guess, from the Boomtown Rats back in, when would that be, 1977?
77. Yeah. We came over to London. We just signed up with Ensign Records, who were a subsidiary of Phonogram. And that was our first release, which amazingly went into the charts. I mean, much to our surprise, it worked. We had a song that was our statement of intent, if you will. I don't want to be like you, I want to be like me. It was very much the sort of mood and the flavour of the time in this country, but also in Ireland, where we came from. We formed the band out of a necessity, really, to do something. Ireland was a dreary, impoverished, murderful backwater.
Yeah.
The corruption and the murder and so on of the 70s. We recognised that I suppose you could say our band started off in a very benign way, but actually we soon realised that we could make a difference. And the way we made that difference was to leave Ireland, sadly, in some ways, but it became a purpose.
Yes, of course. Well, how would you have described the Boomtown Rats back then? Would you have described yourselves as fiercely independent individuals?
Yeah, we were a gang.
Right.
We were out to prove a point and to make a point that actually our music was worth something. It's very hard to do that on a local basis. Mm. And so we did a national tour with a couple of other bands. Didn't attract a huge amount of attention. What really got us noticed was when we started, we did some demos. We came over here to scout around the record companies. And all of a sudden, we had four major labels.
Wow.
This is going, I'm still talking back 1976 here. And so we showcased in Dublin, our hometown, rather than come over here. And ended up with a deal, as I said, with Ensign Records. And that was an ongoing deal we had. I think we did six albums altogether over 10 years. And after a succession of hits, we went from the first release, which was the song you've just heard. Every song we brought out subsequent to that went higher in the charts. It was the crest of a wave.
Yes, a golden path, as it were.
Absolutely.
Bob, obviously, the front man, and very charismatic as he can be, and very difficult as he can be at times as well. I mean, you know...
He's probably listening. Watch out.
Oh, okay, fair enough. But, I mean, you know, was Bob's character the key to sort of pushing that success, Bob, or was it the gang element?
Bob was the, you know, in any gang, you've got to have a leader, and Bob was and still is very much the leader of the gang. You know, you listen to his intent through his lyrics.
Yeah.
And actually, I feel, and this is not just because I'm a Boomtown rat, but if you read his lyrics, they carry great weight and meaning. Mm. You know, he always has been and still is a musical activist, not just musical, but an activist, let's call it. And through the music, you can say things perhaps that you might not otherwise be able to say so easily, and or let's say that what you're saying is more acceptable.
Yeah.
And Bob is actually, as a part of our album release, which we can come to later, is bringing out a book of all his lyrics, which read very, very well, actually.
So is it difficult being as part of a band with such a character as Bob? You know, say you need a leader, but also, you know, that can also create friction at times, of course.
Yeah, he's a pain in the ass some of the time. That's just how it is, you know. Yeah. And there are frictions within any team or group. Not struggling as to, or fighting as to who would be leader, but just the way that the dynamics and the hierarchy works. In an office situation, or most organizations, you have a sort of written hierarchy of who's boss and then who's second, third in command, et cetera, et cetera. In a band, that evolves naturally, so you have a natural pecking order, which should make it easier in a way. But no, it's never a bed of roses. But, you know, we were a gang, a unit, and we were totally concurrent within that unit.
Sure, yeah.
And we were hungry. We really wanted to make a statement at that time. And it wasn't about fitting in with the whole punk thing. It happened to sort of coincide, and a lot of the same values were the values that we had, as did the Pistols and the Jam and the Clash and Stranglers, etc. But we because we'd come from Ireland, as I explained earlier, we came with a different agenda.
Yeah, yeah. So what do you think when you think of that 10 years of success? And, you know, you can reel off the hits, you know,
yeah.
Rat Trap, I Don't Like Mondays,
yep.
Banana Republic, etc.
Yep.
Are you, you know, when you perhaps hear one on the radio nowadays, what wells up inside you?
Sadly, you hear Mondays more often than the others.
Of course,
And Mondays has been sort of done to death, and it's really not indicative of the band. That said, hey, I wouldn't be here without it, all that stuff.
Not going to knock it. No,
yeah, I'm not going to knock it, but it's nice. It would be nice to hear, say, Banana Republic a bit more often because of the lyrical content and also because of the diversity of style of music. But really, the guitar band is what we always were. You know, we were two guitars. The sound was loud. Vulgar is what a friend has described it, a vulgar guitar sound, a rage, a noise, a racket. And it would be nice to hear the other songs of the old ones. You've got, Looking After Number One, which we've just heard.
Yep.
You've got She's So Modern, Mary the Fourth Form. It goes on and on. There's a sort of list of hits, Rat Trap in part, although that's more tightly arranged.
Yes, of course.
A bit more studied.
And were you... If there wasn't the Boomtown Rats, would there have been, say, a U2 or the success of the U2? Did the Boomtown Rats, you know, open the the field of play, if you like, for people like Bono and the Boys?
Yeah, I think very much so. I mean, there's a documentary that we're bringing out with the album next month, which illustrates that perfectly, you know, with comments from Bono himself, actually, about how the Rats performing in Dublin just shortly after after we'd signed up, we came back and we did a concert there in Dalymount Park with Thin Lizzy. And Thin Lizzy were our mates, and they'd sort of helped pave the way for us a little bit. But I think the, because of the success of the Rats, we did open the doors for Irish music, Irish culture. You know, I know it's pop music, you might say only pop music, but actually pop culture is very important to people, and people enjoy music in all sorts of ways. But it also carries meaning.
You've mentioned already that you've got a new Boomtown Rats album coming out, and it's the first Boomtown Rats studio album, well, in more years than we actually care to mention. We're going to talk a bit more about the content of the album and how the Boomtown Rats have sort of refound the love for each other in a few moments' time. But the single from the album is Trash Glam Baby. Now, I know Bob's spoken about how this came about himself, in that I think he was in a shop somewhere in London at some point. But this is typical Bob as the lyricist, isn't it? Do you want to explain a bit more that you know about the song?
A little bit. I mean, typical Bob, you know, he's in a charity shop. He sees this girl, and I suppose a lot of us, I go to charity shops as well. But just the whole mood of buying secondhand clothes, and then the sort of slightly seedy life that she might be having. This is all a figment of his imagination, but it comes across in the video, if you've seen it. And she goes to the Moth Club, and she ends up dancing on her own. And she's a kind of mixture of styles, you know, the trash, the glam, the baby. Describes it all quite well. It's, so what we're about here is a mood, no particular message, but you can see behind what the music represents is a passion, a noise. It's kind of modern blues.
I got my diamond and my stick on stars. I got my new.
It's Richard Green on the BBC this weekend, and that is Trash Glam Baby from the Boomtown Rats from the brand new album Citizens of Boomtown. The album title there, I guess, sort of alludes to what you were saying at the start of our conversation, that you are citizens of Boomtown. You were that gang that you were talking about at the start.
I think, if you go back to the origins of the band and where we got our name from, Woody Guthrie, who was a musical activist, we felt... the Boomtown Rats were, if I can just explain, from a book called Bound for Glory. Yep. And they were ostracized by the community. We identified with that. We were different. We were this gang that we were trying to be different and trying to say something. We had a purpose behind us. That's translated over the years into us actually identifying again with Boomtown. Boomtown is a place where we feel happy, feel comfortable. We want to open this up as a community, a virtual town, which is Boomtown, and that's what we're expressing through the new album.
Yeah, the new album, the first studio album in 36 years. I mean,
you know, is it that long?
It is that long. I mean, the obvious question is why. I mean, I know in the mid 1980s, after the 10 years of success, Bob obviously had Live Aid and all that stuff. I was there at Wembley on that very day when you were performing, and he was slapping the table, etc. I mean, obviously that created a different dynamic and caused a bit of a fracture.
Yeah.
Let's put it that way. But why then, after 36 years, go back into the studio? Because an album you would have produced in the early 1980s would have sold by the bucket load. An album in 2020 is a different kettle of fish altogether, isn't it?
I think you have to look at the sort of the career of the band over that first 10 years, where we came in, we conquered, we peaked, we dwindled. Live Aid changed the world. Musically, we weren't really a part of that. However, you know, we were there. So as a band, that kind of marked perhaps the beginning of the very end. We went on for another year after that. And then we thought, well, we've done it. We've done enough. We went our own separate ways. And then all these years later, I mean, I would never have believed this possible, but we contacted each other and we thought, why not put it back together?
Yeah.
Because we still had, and now is time to do stuff again, we feel, as a band. Okay, we're a bit older, but so what? You know, that you can still do it. And this is what we've gathered. You know, we've done the last 5 or 6 years, we've been doing a lot of festivals, a lot of shows, and the audience reaction has been very good. The fear would be, oh, you know, can the Rats still do it? But whatever about that, we worked long and hard to create that atmosphere, that attitude, that racket, that noise that we had before, but in a different way, and in a more contemporary sound. But this marks a whole departure into new material, because we signed up with a major record label, BMG. You know, we played them our demos, and I remember getting a call from Bob. He'd been over to Hamburg to play to the head of BMG, and he said they want to sign us straight away.
Brilliant.
Amazing. I mean, extraordinary, you know, at this stage. So we've worked up the songs into this now, and we feel that it's every bit as good, if not better, than the earlier stuff. Just to sort of deal with the nostalgia element. We've done a lot of the songs that were hits back in the day, and hopefully the audiences will recognize them. We never really set out to make it a nostalgia event. And Bob points out that the lyrics of most of the songs, you know,
ooh, very contemporary. Yeah.
Someone's looking at you, looking after number. They still apply. Banana Republic.
Yeah.
Banana Republic might apply to our friends in America now more than... than in Ireland, but you know, the message behind the song can be interpreted in many different ways. The one that doesn't quite hang is She's So Modern. Is all about She's So 1970s.
Well, true. Yeah.
But you can still apply that to a young lady these days. I mean, but no, the main weight of the lyrics behind the band is still as valid now as it ever was. And then, you know, this album is all about, as I say, a kind of more contemporary blues sound. There's not such a an understandable, well, let's say the lyrics are more open to interpretation,
sure,
this time around.
Sure.
It's not such a direct musical activist statement.
And Simon, what's it like then being a Boomtown Rat now and playing live? Because it's going to be a different feel to the forthcoming tour, because as you say, it's not going to be the sort of retro fest, the nostalgia fest that you've perhaps
Well, it still
done.
Has to be. It still has
well,
to be.
Largely, but you're going to throw new songs in, of course.
We're going to throw new songs in, but you cannot ignore the fact that this is the Boomtown Rats. Our pedigree is all of the songs we've talked about from the 70s, 80s. Those are the songs that people know. We can't just go out there and not do Rat Trap and Mondays and, you know, She's So Modern. Some of us might prefer to do all the new stuff. And like any band, when you've got a new album, you want to play all your new stuff. And I think for a contemporary band, yes, you can do that. But if you've had hits, you've still got to play the songs that people want to hear.
Sure. You're going on tour. Nearest to us is Cardiff, the Great Hall, on April the 18th, going all around the country, Birmingham, Liverpool, Manchester, London at the Palladium.
Yep.
For goodness sake, everybody plays the Palladium now. Sting, Madonna, everybody, etc.
That's right.
How come you haven't persuaded Bob or the Wicked promoters or your management to come down to the West Country where you reside?
Well, I think we will do. This tour is not, it's not that many. What is it, 11 dates?
Yeah.
So hopefully in the autumn we'll put together another, and we might include Exeter, Plymouth, those towns down this way. So I'm looking forward to that.
And the album, Citizens of Boomtown, I'm just looking at some of the song titles now. Sweet Thing, Monster, Passing Through, Here's a Postcard. We're going to play the Boomtown Rats, the Boomtown Rats.
Yes.
As our closing track, because that sort of emphasises, doesn't it, what the Boomtown Rats were about and are about.
Absolutely. It illustrates what the qualities that I've been talking about, the noise, the racket. The
drumming at the start.
There's a bit of that.
There is, isn't there, Simon? Yeah.
And this song, actually, we had before the rest of the album, and we've been playing that at gigs, and it's been we've been doing it as the last song on the set, and it's been going down well. It's a great dancey, boppy tune, and people seem to like it.
Yeah, we'll play that in a moment. 13th of March, the album is coming out. Excited, trepidatious? What's your gut feeling, Simon, as the album's, you know, ready to go?
Yeah, I'm very excited about it. I think the reaction to the album has been fantastic. We won Best Comeback Single of the Year the other day, which is very gratifying. It's very good to hear that we can be heard again, and that we have that space to do that in. It's very exciting. Who knows what it'll turn into? There's so much competition.
You mean Bob hasn't arranged a 5-album deal?
It's not about that. It's about getting it across to the public. And you know, obviously we didn't have to do much to persuade the record company to sign us up. That's only a small part of what you have to do, and we have to establish the name of the band again in some way, and that's why this whole Citizens of Boomtown thing as a branding. We've got the documentary, Bob's book of lyrics, we've got the album, we've got videos to support it, we're out supporting it on tour as well, so we're exposing ourselves as much as we possibly can. Fingers crossed.
Brilliant. Well, it's good that the Rats are back. I'm certainly looking forward to hopefully seeing you live again, as I did a couple of years ago. Simon Crowe, thank you very much for joining us.
Thanks, Richard. All the best.
That is surprisingly dancey, isn't it? It's the Boomtown Rats by the Boomtown Rats. It's the closing track of their album called Citizens of Boomtown, which is out in March time here in the UK. Now, you know what we do on Richard Green's Retro Show? We like to...